Welcome to Unfiltered. Here's tonight's headline. It's happened again. 12 people are dead, 4 injured, 3 of whom are in intensive care after a man opened fire in the Virginia Beach Municipal Center on Friday. It marks the worst mass shooting of 2019 in America, and the breaking details are horrifying. Employees at the municipal building heard loud bangs, yelling, screaming, muffled gunshots. They pushed desks against the doors in their office, hid while hugging and holding each other as the gunshots continued. One employee told reporters it felt like hours. Virginia Beach Vice Mayor James Wood said the shooting is, quote, without a doubt, the most horrific thing that our city has experienced. This morning, President Trump made his first comments on the tragedy on Twitter. He said, spoke to Virginia Governor Ralph Northam last night and the mayor and vice mayor of Virginia Beach this morning to offer condolences to that great community. The federal government is there and will be for whatever they may need. God bless the families and all. Reactions from 2020 candidates have poured in as well and continued today. Most included calls for action. Cory Booker said, we can and will pass common sense gun safety laws to end these tragedies. Kamala Harris, we cannot continue to stand idly by. Bernie Sanders, the days of the NRA controlling Congress and writing our gun laws must end. Congress must listen to the American people and pass gun safety legislation. Pete Buttigieg, it is unacceptable for America to remain the only developed country where this is routine. We must act. And Elizabeth Warren, how many lives will it take before Congress acts to end this crisis? Now, without a doubt, we have a problem in this country. There's a moral rot, a breakdown of civil society, a sickness that we have not figured out how to address. Something is eating us alive from the inside. I don't pretend to have the answers. Politicians, by the way, they don't either. You may think you do. You may think the answer is fewer guns or more guns, more mental health resources, more research, more funding, or a combination of all of that. I don't know, but what I do know is politics is not going to solve this problem. So tonight, politics will have to wait. Other folks can go there. Tonight, we focus on the victims, the survivors in the hospital, the investigation, the unanswered questions, the community that's been torn apart. And this is what local law enforcement has asked us to do. Take a listen to the police chief, who I'll be speaking with shortly, in the emotional press conference this morning.
The suspect, and this will be the only time we will announce his name, is Dwayne Craddock. We must keep the dignity and respect of the victims first and foremost. And all the questions that I've received up to this point, I particularly want to thank the members of the media for understanding that and for keeping their dignity and their respect first and foremost in everything that you've been talking about.
We will honor that request. Here are the names we should remember. Lakita C. Brown, Tara Welch Gallagher, Mary Louise Gale, Ryan Keith Cox, Robert Bobby Williams, Richard H. Nettleton, Michelle Missy Langer, Catherine A. Nixon, Joshua O. Hardy, Herbert Burt Snelling, Christopher Kelly Rapp, Alexander Mikhail Gusev. Okay, I start by going to Erica Hill with the latest. Erica, there was a presser from officials just this afternoon. What was revealed in that latest press conference?
So, Essie, what we learned this afternoon, specifically, we learned about the weapons. From the ATF, we learned that there were two 45 caliber guns recovered inside at the crime scene behind me. In a search of the suspect's home, two more guns were found as well. Of the four, we know that three, they are still continuing to investigate, but three of them do appear to be have been purchased legally. The two that were found on the scene were purchased in 2016 and 2018. We don't know about a motive, and that could be difficult because, of course, the shooter was killed yesterday after engaging in what was referred to as a very long gun battle with the responding officers. The other thing I want to point out is that all of the officials here have really talked about the fact that these four officers who arrived on scene, they credit with keeping the death toll down, actually, that it did not go higher. So there has been a lot of appreciation, a lot of praise for those four officers. We can tell you there was some talk about whether the shooter was a disgruntled employee, whether he'd been fired. The police chief making it very clear he had not been fired. In fact, he had a conversation with a coworker earlier in the day who described him as a good person, and they wished each other to have a happy weekend. We should get a timeline tomorrow, Essie, from the police department, from when the shots rang out as to what happened next. That's been a big question. Of course, it's an ongoing investigation. The FBI taking over the evidence recovery at this point. And you talked about the focus on the victims. That's much of what we heard as well. The mayor, who I spoke with earlier today, said in that press conference he wants this city to be known as a community of love and support, that they are all about resilience, and that they will recover from this, and that love and support and caring for one another is not something that they see happening for just the next few days, but that they will define themselves by that as a community, not by the horror and the tragedy that happened behind me. Essie?
That's powerful. Erica, thanks so much for your reporting. Appreciate it. Now I'd like to bring in Virginia Beach Police Chief James Cervera. First, our condolences go out to your community. We are mourning with you, not for you. I do want to keep our focus tight, as you requested. So what can you tell us about the victims that are still recovering in the hospital?
The victims are, in fact, recovering in the hospital. One is listed in fair to stable condition. The other three are still listed in serious condition. So our thoughts are with the families. Yeah. As far as the other victims, the deceased victims, we have honor guard officers from both the police and the fire department assigned to each family to make sure that we have direct liaison to those families.
And Chief, we learned one police officer was wounded, but reportedly saved by his bulletproof vest. How is he doing?
He's doing well. I just came from his house. We had a great conversation. You know, outwardly, cops are doing great. Inwardly, this is going to affect him and all the officers that responded to this scene. It's going to affect them for the rest of their life. We have to remember that. But they ran to the gunfire because that's what they do.
Yeah, speak a little bit more, if you can, about the first responders, not just the cops, but first responders from hospitals, EMTs, et cetera.
Our fire department and our EMT department work very close with the police department. We train very close together in situations such as this. As a matter of fact, we had a training event on March 30th. It was a large-scale event, so they know that when they respond to the scene that there's a warm zone, a cold zone. Our officers know where to bring casualties into one repository area. And I just have to say over and over again that the first cops in that building did a fantastic job in locating the suspect and in neutralizing the suspect. And then all the responding first responders, be it fire, be it EMTs, were all there to give the care to the wounded and as well as to the police officers. Mm-hmm. Again, they train together, we work together. We're a seamless emergency response system in our city.
So in that press conference that we played, you were very clear you were only going to mention the shooter's name once. I won't repeat it, and I appreciate your emphasis on that. But I do want to hear from you why you made that decision so that it's clear to our viewers and also colleagues in the media.
Well, for a couple of reasons. First and foremost, I don't think he deserves to have his name read any other time than at one specific time so we could identify him. Secondly, I want to make sure that our city, that the rest of the country understands that we have 12 victims who did not make it to the next day. They did not make it out of the building. I want other people to know we have other victims who are seriously injured. We have a complete workforce in our city that's traumatized by this. We have first responders who went into harm's way immediately to take care of that situation. And I don't think this individual deserves to have his name read any more than once to identify who he is.
Well, I appreciate you explaining that, Chief. Something else that struck me while listening to you earlier was you stressing that this was a prolonged shootout. You said it was not a traditional police officer shootout. What did you mean by that, just so I'm clear?
Well, usually when an officer is involved in a shooting, what is commonly known as an OIS, there's a minimal number of shots that are fired. That's just the way it happens. It's also a very short period of time, seconds. Hmm. In this particular case, it was not a minimal number of shots that were fired. This individual immediately, actually, he, quote, had to jump on one of our officers and open fire on that officer. That officer was able to take a tactical position. The other officers came and took tactical positions, and that gunfight lasted for a much longer period of time. Multiple rounds were fired by the suspect and by our police officers. Remember, this individual had extended magazines with extended rounds. So I can, when I say it was a long-term firefight, is really the word, That's what it was. It was not a bang, bang, and it's over. It right. continued to go on. There was movement by the suspect, movement by the officers to get that tactical advantage to be able to neutralize them.
I imagine whether you're law enforcement or a sanitation worker or a public school teacher, this attack on these city employees must feel like an attack on the city itself. I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I'm wondering how you're sort of approaching this.
Well, you know, for a police agency, first and foremost, we believe in the sanctity of life, all lives in our city, all of the people who visit our city. We truly believe that. That's why we are in this business. There is something to it when it happens within your community, let's say, within your family, folks that you see every day. You may not know them, you may not know their names, but somewhere along the line, you've crossed paths with each other. There's something about a situation like this happening in a city building. Remember, these officers were only about 100 yards away from that building, so they immediately responded to it.